And with me now is Frederic Wehrey. He's a former U.S. Air Force officer who served as a military attaché in Libya. He's been to the country often since the overthrow of Gaddafi and is now a senior associate at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Why this violence? I mean, there are many different players involved, but give us a sense of who the key ones are. What's going on?
Well, at a very basic sense, there are these two rival factions from rival towns, Misrata and Zintan. The Zintanis have controlled the airport. The Misratans are allied with an Islamist militia that enjoyed support in the previous parliament. That parliament is no longer in power. And I think these Islamist militias felt like the window was closing, that they had to act now to seize the airport from these Zintanis that were holding the airport there. There's also some factional politics that relate to what's going on in the east. You had a renegade general, General Khalifa Haftar, who launched an operation in the east against the Islamists. He's partnered with those Zintani militias that are controlling the airport. So in this very complex web of dynamics, of alliances, it's finally arrived to Tripoli, and these Misratans felt like they had to act.
And is it right to see this all within this larger context of post-Gaddafi Libya, about what happened? We talked about it as it was happening, I recall.
Right. It is. I mean, this is a country that under Gaddafi really had no state institutions. It didn't have an army. It didn't have a police. It's only gotten worse since the revolution. What has happened really is that the provisional government, the transitional government, put these militias on its payroll. The militias are getting funding from Libya's oil wealth, and they've really mushroomed. They've become their own entities. They've grabbed the oil ports. They've grabbed the airports. They control armories. There's no mediator. There's no referee to keep them apart. And this is what we're seeing right now with the fighting.
When you refer to a provisional government, is there an actual functioning government right now?
There is, but it's incredibly weak. I mean, there's a parliament, a new parliament that's supposed to meet in Benghazi. There are questions about its security. The last parliament was really rife with militia pressure. It was subjected to militia pressure. The prime minister is caught in the middle between these various factions. So the real story of Libya is that there's no one faction that can really compel or coerce the others, really.
And to what extent is oil a factor? Is that what they're fighting over? One of the things they're certainly fighting over.
It is. Several months ago, you had the blockade of oil facilities, of oil production facilities by a militia in the east that was seeking greater autonomy for that region. And that sent the Libyan economy into a tailspin, and the country's still recovering from that. That's why you have these long lines for gasoline. I mean, the country, given its oil wealth, should not be in such a state right now, but it's because of this factional fighting among the militias.
An important aspect of this, clearly, is the degree to which Libya becomes a kind of failed state, where militant groups are operating freely and affecting the rest of the region.
Well, that's a huge concern, and we've already seen Libyan weapons from the armories, Gaddafi's armories, showing up in conflicts in Syria, in Gaza.
In Africa.
In Africa, of course. It's destabilized Mali. And we know that there are Libyan jihadists training there and going to fight in other theaters of conflict. So from a regional perspective, you're absolutely right. I mean, this is a huge concern that there are these terrorist actors, al-Qaeda, that will exploit this ungovernance, and they'll set up shop in these ungoverned territories of Libya.
What about the role of the U.S. and allies? I mean, is there a role? How much sway does the U.S. have at this point?
Well, again, I think you have to go back to the overthrow of Gaddafi, that the U.S. policy from that point was really to put a Libyan face on this revolution. And that, obviously, the real sensitivity to another nation-building exercise, the light footprint approach. The U.S. is involved in training Libyan society and helping Libyan political actors. There's a planned effort to help train the Libyan army. The United Nations is also involved, so are the British. The problem really is one of security and access. I mean, after, of course, the tragic attack in Benghazi, there was a real, I think, sensitivity that this is a dangerous place, and we need to protect our people and our diplomats, and that hindered movement around the country, and it hindered access to Libyans.
Well, and then the State Department pulled out embassy personnel now. Is there a level of frustration on the part in Washington about our inability to influence things and, in fact, having to leave?
Well, I think there is. And I think the sense I get is that in Washington is that they feel that there's just no partner on the other side. They want to help the Libyans, but the Libyans first have to help themselves. I mean, this is a government that is in disarray, that is weak. And I think there was just a red line that was crossed where the embassy was caught in the middle of this shelling and they pulled out. And so I do think the Libyans themselves need to step up to the plate before the outside community can help.
Well, so very briefly, is that the potential way out? Has anybody got ideas about how some end to this?
When I visited Libya, I mean, I was really struck by the level of you know, pragmatism among certain politicians. And Libyans do have this tendency to walk things back from the brink. I mean, it's a small country. There are divides, but it's not the sort of deep ethnic sectarian divides that's tearing Iraq or Syria apart. So I think the Libyans, as we speak, are trying to negotiate some sort of climb down from this crisis and a ceasefire.
All right. Frederic Wehrey, thanks so much.
My pleasure. Thanks.